Let's look at this endowment assurance policy for which we can compute the expected profit margin. Okay, a life office issues a 4-year non-profit endowment assurance policy. So the term of the policy is 4 years and the type of the policy is endowment assurance. Alright, to a male aged 61 years exact, for a sum assured of 100,000, which is payable on survival to the end of the term. The payments are being made only at the end of the term or at the end of the year of death if earlier. So there is a survival as well as the death part. Premiums are paid annually in advance throughout the term of the policy. Okay, there is a surrender benefit payable equal to the return of premiums paid with no interest. So there is a surrender benefit which is equal to the return of premiums. The benefit is payable at the end of the year of surrender only. So it's not paid immediate. The following assumptions: mortality is AM90 to select, surrenders, there are none that have happened, interest rate is 4%, initial expense is 500, renewal expense is 50 per annum. There is a renewal expense of 50 plus 2.5% of the premium. There is a 2.5% of the premium. Okay, in so here the premium is paid on an annual basis. So which means, because it's a 4-year policy, the expected present value of the premiums is nothing but PA double dot 61:4. And the 61 is a select. That's the only difference. Right? So from here I should be able to find out the expected present value of the premiums. So this would be the expected present value of the premiums. All right, expected present value of the premiums, here A double dot 61 I require, A double dot 65 I require, L65, L61 select, then I require 4P61, then I also require V power 4, because the interest rate is 4%, I'll take it as 1.04. 1 by 1.04 to the power 4. I'll take it as 1 by 1.04 to the power 4. The rest of the numbers I'll get from AM92 select table. I require A61.46894. A65 I require, which is 0.52786. Then I require L65 and L61. L65 comes as 8821.2612. L61 comes from the select table 9184.9687. So the 4P61 is L65 divided by L61, and from here obviously I can get the expected present value of the premiums, which comes out as A61 minus V per 4 times 4P61 times A65, works out to this much. So this number is the expected present value of the premium. So this number I multi okay, I require a double dots, right? Not yes. Here small change. I require a double dot 61. I have to look out for not 0.46 and all. This is 13.808 and a double dot 65 is 12.276. So it is actually 3.72p. This is the expected present value of the premiums. Now here we are also saying that 100,000 is the death benefit. 100,000 is the death benefit that is paid either at the survival to the end of the term or even on the death, which means it's an endowment assurance which I can take it exactly like A61-4. So there is a death benefit as well as a survival benefit in this. So the death benefit can be computed separate, and probably A61-4 I can very well get it from 65 minus X kind of a table. A61-4 I'll try to get from a 65 minus X kind of table for a 4. So we have A61:4, A select 61:4. I can directly get from this particular table 0.85654. Right, so from here I can say expected present value of the death and surrender benefits or maturity benefits, this number multiplied by whatever is the amount, 10,000, which is 85,000 is coming out to be the expected present value. 85,654 comes out to be the expected present value of the death benefit. Then we also have the initial expenses of 500 and renewal expense of 50. So the initial expense is 500, renewal expense of 50 per annum. So if I am talking about a renewal expense, it is 50 per annum only on the second and the subsequent premium dates. So it is like 50 times this renewal expense is incurred. Renewal expense, I'll call it as 50 times whatever was this number, because this is operating out, but it this should not include the first, so I'll subtract the one. So renewal expense is coming out to this much. The present value of the renewal expense is coming out to this much. And at the same time, we are talking about 2.5% of the premium. So it also comes out as 2.5% of whatever is this number minus 1, that much times P. So 3.72 PE, so I'll take it as 2.5%. So it's actually renewal expense is this much. So overall, the now I can find out the premium computation, which is the expected present value of the death benefit, which is this much, expected present value of the expenses, there is an initial expense and renewal expense, which are numbers. And along with that, there is I'll divide it by the premiums minus the renewal expense, which is in the form of a premium. So this gives me that the premium that has to be charged for this kind of a policy is going to be 23,565. This is the premium that has to be charged. Now this is where I'll get into the profit testing for this endowment assurance policy. So years I'll call this a 4-year policy. The premiums are received at the outset itself. This is the premium amount that I have received at the outset, at the beginning of each of these four periods. And expenses wise now, the initial expense for me is 500, but the renewal expense is, okay, there is 136 plus this number times the premium. There is a 136 plus this number times the premium, which is telling me that the expense, renewal expense, okay, here it's not 136, sorry. Renewal expense in each period, what is the renewal expense in each period? It is 50 per annum plus 2.5% of the premium. So I should not find the present value of that, 2.5% of the premium. So renewal expense in each of the cases is going to be this much, right? Now I also require the reserve requirement. Here I have to set the reserves. I have to maintain the reserves in each of the periods, right? Because it's also being said, in addition, the company holds net premium reserves. So it's a kind of a reserve that the company is holding, calculated using the AM 92 ultimate mortality and interest of 4% per annum. So it has to hold the reserves also. So at the, so probably somewhere if I look at the reserves, how much it should hold at the end of the first year, how much reserve does it require? I can very well, at the end of the first year, the reserve requirement, I can very well call it as A minus of A double dot 62 colon 3 divided by A double dot 61 colon 4. So this could be my the reserve requirement. So for each of the years, I can directly pull them from the corresponding 65 minus X table. Right, I'll pull it from the 65 minus X table. So for one, so for at the end of the 1 year, I'll take it with respect to 1 minus of 62 colon 3. Right, A double dot 62 colon 3 is 2.857 divided by 61 colon 4. 61 colon 4, I'll still look at it with respect to select life, right? Because I'm referring to, I mean, the, oh, these are set using AM 92 ultimate mortality. So I will take the ultimate mortality 61.4 itself, which is 3.722. So at the end of the first year, the reserve requirement, the reserve that is needed to be maintained at the end of the first year, the required reserve is around 23,240. That much of reserve is required at the end of the first year. Similarly, now I can look at the end of second year also, I'll take it as 100,000 times 1 minus of A63.2, 1.951 divided by 3.722. So at the end of the second year, the reserve requirement becomes 47,000. And at the end of the third year, it directly becomes 100,000 times 1 minus of 1 divided by 3.722. So the reserve at the end of the third year will become 73,122. So this is what is the requirement for the reserves also. So that much has to be set aside in each of the years. So initially expenses are this much, So what I am looking at is the opening reserve, the beginning period reserve. Right now in the first year there will not be any. So the beginning period reserve requirement is zero. So whatever is the balance now for each of the years. So for the first year the balance is nothing but out of this premium there is some reserve that is getting added up minus the expenses. So the balance in each of these years. So the reserves, let's look at, we have to add up. So the balance in each of the years is going to be this much. This would be invested to earn an interest, and we know that this interest that would be applicable. The it assumed that 5% per annum is the interest that is typically earned. So if I look at this 5%, there is 11.53 as the interest that came out in the first year. Now comes a few more things. The life of is assumes the same mortality and expense assumptions as the pricing basis. So now I have to build actually the mortality or multiple decrement table, because there is a possibility that a person will leave both because of death as well as because of surrender. So we will have to look at a multiple decrement table for these 4 years. So I have the QX. We'll have to look at the QX one with respect to death and QX one with respect to surrender. But with respect to surrender, we are given very clearly that 5% of the policy is still in force at the end of the 1, 2, 3 years surrender. So we'll take that the 5% is the possibility of surrender QX in each of the first 3 years. Whereas for the death, I'll use similar assumptions as the pricing basis. So for the pricing basis, whatever are the assumptions that have gone in. So I'll go and look out for QX in the AM92 table. AM92 table, I'll look out for Q61. So here, because it's a select, I'll take it as 0.006433. Whereas for 62, I'll take it as 61 plus 1. So I'll make it 0.009696. And from the next periods onwards for 63 and all, I'll take it as ultimate 0.011344, and I'll also take it as 0.012716. So for these 4 years, these are going to be my QX. And of course, here QXD and AQXD are one and the same, because the death, I mean surrenders, are happening only at the end of the year. So they are not assumed to occur uniformly throughout the year. So obviously, I can look at AQXD being the same as the QXD. So I'll take this as my QXD for each of the periods. Whereas AQXS come into picture because the death can happen any time, so which will become QXS into 1 minus of QXD. Right? AQX of surrender, I'll get it as QX of surrender times 1 minus of QX for death. So if I'm using that formula, it goes like QX per surrender times 1 minus QX per death. So there is around 4.96, and probably in each of the periods, finally in the final year, I'm not expecting any. So here now I can very well go with APX. APX always comes as the subtraction of all of them. So minus this will give me the APX. So So this is what is the number that is corresponding to APX. And from here, if I have to look at the proportion of the policies, initially if it is 1, at the end of the first year, I am seeing around 94% of the policies are existing, and probably 83% of the policies are existing at the end of the fourth year. So that is what is the mortality and probably the proportion of the policies that are existing. Now, okay, this is the interest that has got built out, and out of this I have to make a death claim. There is one requirement for me for making the death claims. How much is the death claim? 100,000 is typically getting paid. On any death, 100,000 is the amount that is getting paid. So I'll take 100,000 multiplied by the probability of death. So 100,000 multiplied by the probability of death is giving me 643 is the expected values of the death claim, 969 in the second, and so on. Similarly, if I have to look at the surrender claim, expected present value of the surrender claims, I'll look at how much is the surrender amount here, which is the total summation of the premiums. So for the first year, it is, this is the total premium amount, right? I'll take it as the summation of the premium amount. So I'm taking it as the premium in the first year. This I am multiplying it with the proportion of surrender. This is the probability of surrender. So 1170 comes out to be the surrender claim expense in the first year, 2333 in the second, 3494 in the third. Then similarly, there is a maturity claim expense that is required, which will come only in the final year. And that maturity claim also I am paying it as 100,000, but this is paid only to those people who are alive at the beginning of the third year and who are alive, who did not die in the final year. So the expected maturity claim amount is this much. And the next thing which we are trying to see is the reserve part. Right, there is a reserve requirement now, and we need a kind of a reserve that is requiring at the end of each of the periods. There is a requirement of the reserve which we have computed at the end of the first year. The reserves that are required is around 23,000, but this reserve is required only for those policies which have survived that particular period. I really don't require the reserves for those policies which are expired during that specific period. So the reserves are required only for those policies that would be surviving for that particular year. So which means this reserve amount multiplied by 94%. So the reserve that is required at the end of the first year is only that much. Similarly, in case of the second, okay, this is the reserve that is required, but the policies that are surviving in that year is only this. So I require only up to the extent of 44,000. And even in the third year, the reserve that is required is 73,000 multiplied by 93, which is resulting in some 68,687. So these are the reserves that are required in each of the years. So here I could typically look at the overall profit that is coming up in this year over year, right? On this balance, There is a beginning reserve. There is a beginning reserve. On this beginning reserve, there is a new balance that got added, which has fetched some interest. And on the top of that, I am paying a death claim. I am paying a surrender claim. There is an expected maturity claim, and there is an expected increase in the value of the reserves. So the net is what giving me the profit in each of the cases. And whatever are the reserves at the end of the first year, they would typically become, I mean, with the interest and everything, they will become the reserves for the second, third years as such. So here I can say that the beginning of the period reserves in each of the periods are this much. So this much reserves, and this much reserves is actually adding up to the balance. So I don't need to add up the reserves anymore because it's adding up to the balance altogether. So I will not add up the reserves as a part of the profit testing part. Right, it will duplicate the counting process. So here it is 468 and then 407, 716 and 800. So here we can very well, these are the cash flows that are coming out. Now based on these cash flows, actually I will consider the proportions that are the proportions of policies that are alive in each of the policies, each of the cases. So which I'll directly take from here, these are the proportions of the policies that are in force compared to the ones at the start. And I would also look at the discount factor. Here I'm looking at the discounting being done, the risk discount rate of 8%. So I'll take it as 1 by 1.08, and from the second period onwards I'll do it as 0.08 for each one separately. And probably here I'll find out the present values for each one of them, which is nothing but the profit multiplied by the proportion multiplied by the discount rate. So the present values of each of them is working out to be somewhere around this. So the overall NPV of this particular assignment, of this particular policy, I'm getting the NPV of it is around 1797. Right? Similarly, I can talk about the expected. So for the premiums also, I could do the same thing. Premiums have been collected here, right? So I can find out the expected present value of premiums also. The way I'll get it is, again, right, the present value, right, I'll take it as present value of premiums. See, for the first one, it is exactly the same, right? Everyone has paid. In case of the second, those people, out of this premium, I am looking at the policies that are in force. So, which is, I am multiplying it with the proportion of policies that are in force, and I will multiply it with the discount factor of the previous period, because it is paid in the beginning of the second year, not at the end of the second year. So, it's as good as at the end of the first year. So, that's the reason I will take the first year's discount factor, which will give me that the premium present value is around this, and across I am taking the numbers coming out to be around. So this will give me the expected present value of the premium to be the summation of all these, around 77,000, which overall is giving me the profit margin in this assignment, which I get as NPV divided by the expected present value, overall giving me around 2.31%. So if it is a unit based policy, we are doing it in a different way. This is a completely non-unit based, where the reserve setting is very much required, and that reserve setting is typically coming out, the requirement of the reserves in each of the periods is coming out with this kind of a workout. So this is where we can simplify the whole numerical, and we can understand what is the profit margin that is coming out of these set of policies. All right.